is just a little samba built upon a single note. Other notes are bound to follow, but the root is still that note. Now this new one is the consequence of the one we've just been through. As I'm bound to be the unavoidable consequence of you. There's so many people who can talk and talk and talk and just say nothing or nearly nothing. I've used up all the skill I know, and at the end I come to nothing, or nearly nothing. So I come back to my first note, as I must come back to you. Anyone who wants the whole show, re mi fa sol la ti do, he will find himself with no show. Better play the note you know. This is just a little samba.
Hey everybody, let's take our seats. We're about to get started. Good evening, everybody. If you please take your seats, we'll get started. I'm Patrick O'Carroll. I'm with the Task Force for Global Health, and I oversee the health system strengthening programs of the Task Force, which includes TEPHINET. Welcome to the 10th TEPHINET Global Scientific Conference. Theme is the Global FETP Enterprise, Applied Epidemiology in the 21st Century. I'm up here only very briefly to introduce someone to you that I think all of you know very well, so I will keep this brief. But let me say first that after the loss of our dear friend, the former director of TEPHINET, Dr. Dionisio Herrera, those were very big shoes to fill. He's a wonderful, wonderful man. We all know him and loved him very much, and we were very sorry with his passing last December. It was then my duty and my honor to be acting director of TEPHINET for about 8 months. And it was it will always be a highlight of my career, the opportunity to work with the wonderful TEPHINET team here in Atlanta, Georgia, but also the opportunity to work with many of you. It's really been something I will never forget. But my most important duty during that eight-month period was to find someone to come in and to take the helm for TEPHINET, which I believe to be one of the most important public health organizations really in the world. doing one of the most important missions that we have, which is to make sure that every country in the world has the ability to do qualified applied epidemiology. We searched throughout the world. We had actually a raft of very good, very highly qualified candidates, I'm glad to say that, but there was one candidate who stood out above them all, and as I say, this candidate needs no introduction. He's been a longtime friend to TEPHINET, chair of our advisory board, also a very important player in AFINET, and very key in the accreditation process and many other aspects, a dear friend, a dear counselor, and now our new director of TEPHINET. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and welcome Dr. Carl Reddy.
Thank you very much, Patrick, for that very kind introduction. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, FETP trainees, residents, and alumni, program directors, regional network directors, partners, funders, colleagues, friends, fellow conspirators in building a field epidemiology workforce capable of detecting and responding to health threats. It is my pleasure and honor to welcome you this evening to the 10th TEPHINET Global Scientific Conference, which has come home to Atlanta for the very first time. Thank you for taking the time and for making the effort to be here this week. This is an especially exciting time to be working in applied epidemiology capacity development. As FETPs are increasingly being recognized as essential to important global initiatives by international partners. The work of FETPs is clearly complementary to WHO's global strategy on human resources for health. To promote global health security and assure rapid response capacity for epidemic control, field epidemiologists are expanding their skill sets and developing strong collaborations with partners like the CDC and GAON. There is a clear increase in commitment across the world to the One Health paradigm, leading to improved cross-sectoral coordination and collaboration among epidemiologists, veterinarians, and environmentalists. We are actually at this moment at the crossroads of the entire FETP enterprise. And this conference is perfectly timed at this juncture. In order to celebrate the exciting times that we find ourselves in, TEPHINET is actually inviting all current residents of advanced training programs to sign up and become members of TEPHICONNECT. I guess I would be remiss if I didn't mention our previous director and close friend, whom you all, many of you know very well. We at TEPHINET remember with great fondness the previous director, Dr. Dionisio Herrera. He is with us in spirit tonight, and whilst he is still sorely missed, his legacy, his compassion, and his humanity remain with us. The theme of this year's conference is the global FETP enterprise, applied epidemiology in the 21st century. And in keeping with this theme, the various plenary sessions will allow us to look back at what has worked well and forward to a proposed roadmap for how best to strengthen field epidemiology capacity building, individual FETP programs, graduates, the regional network, and the global network TEPHINET in terms of quality and sustainability. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Adam Johnson, a TEPHINET colleague who will sing the US national anthem. In the tradition of the global conference, the national anthem of the host country is always played or sung. And in keeping with that tradition and being the first time in Atlanta, the United States, we'd like Adam to please come on stage and sing the national anthem. May I please ask you to stand?
say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the
Thank you very much, Adam. I think you will agree that was a magnificent rendition. So, Beyonce, sorry about that. I must recognize that TEPHINET has some incredibly skilled and talented people, and we are very proud of them, and I think they raise the organization to new heights. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our distinguished speaker for tonight. He is Dr. Jeffrey Koplan. Dr. Koplan, may I please invite you on stage whilst I give a formal introduction to the audience. So please be prepared. Dr. Koplan has had a very extensive career. So please have a seat, Dr. Koplan. I'll just introduce you and then you can start.
Okay, but the introduction won't be extensive, right?
Okay, Dr. Jeffrey Koplan is an internationally renowned public health leader with more than 40 years of experience. Dr. Koplan is Vice President for Global Health at Emory University. He is co-founder of the International Association of National Public Health Institutes, which you probably know as EANFI. He founded the Emory Global Health Institute in 2006, served as its director until March 2013, and continues to be actively involved in its daily operations in his role as Vice President for Global Health. A former director, 1998 to 2002, and 26-year veteran of the US Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, Dr. Koplan began his public health career in the early 1970s as a member of the CDC's Epidemic Intelligence Service. He has worked on many major public health issues, including infectious diseases such as smallpox, SARS, pandemic influenza, and HIV/AIDS, environmental issues such as the Bhopal chemical disaster, and the health toll of tobacco and chronic diseases, both in the United States and around the globe. From 1994 to 1998, he pursued his interest in enhancing the interactions between clinical medicine and public health by developing and leading the Prudential Center for Healthcare Research. His first collaboration with China was in 1980 as a member of the US PRC Public Health/Health Services Research Joint Committee. Since then, he has made more than 60 visits to China on projects for the World Bank, WHO, CDC, and China's Ministry of Health. He has worked on several World Bank loan projects in China, including serving as the principal advisor on Health Loan 7, health promotion and tobacco control in 7 cities. He has been awarded an honorary professorship at China CDC and named honorary advisor number 1. It almost sounds like James Bond, to China CDC at its formation in 2002. He received the Friendship Award from China in 2013, the highest award China bestows on non-Chinese citizens. Dr. Koplan is a graduate of Yale University, the Mount Sinai School of Medicine, and the Harvard School of Public Health. He is a master of the American College of Physicians and was elected into membership in and service on the Governing Council in the Institute of Medicine. He has served on many advisory groups and consultancies in the United States and overseas, and has written more than 240 scientific papers. He is a trustee of the China Medical Board and the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. Please, a round of applause for Dr. Koplan. Okay.
Thank you. We can turn the lights up in the house, because I've got no slides, and that way I can see you all out there, if that's possible. We'll see if it's possible. Welcome to Atlanta. This isn't technically Atlanta, it's Stone Mountain, but it's close enough, we'll call it Atlanta. We're glad you're here, and good afternoon. All right, good afternoon. All right, that's the best part of the talk. I think I'll leave. Apprentice learning has a long history in the trades. Blacksmiths, coopers, carpenters, brewers, barbers, weavers, tailors, bookbinders. So much so that in English, many of these trades have lived on as family names. I have a friend named Ned Brewer. Have read about Alice Cooper, those of you who are music fans, if that's your type of music. Karen Carpenter, if it's another type of music. In any event, many of these names have become just names, but they date back to apprentice learning when people's crafts were what identify them. I think we all, as field epidemiologists, should do the same and break with our familial traditions. How about Carl Reddy Epidemiologist? That's his last name. Or even better, Patrick O. Epidemiologist. Okay, it doesn't catch on right away, but think about it over the course of the meeting, and maybe we'll get some converts. Being an apprentice and doing apprentice learning is a good way to learn. A master in the trade imparts his or her knowledge and experience, and the next generations of practitioners is born. Many of the elements of this method can be seen in the development at the CDC of the Epidemic Intelligence Service. Apprentice learning, but with some academic book learning thrown in, and yes, occasional bedside learning as well. My own experience with the EIS, Epidemic Intelligence Service, and learning on the job from skilled experts was transformational in my own career and my life. When I went to CDC, I thought I was going for 2 years of government service and then return to academia or possibly return to medical practice. But that apprenticeship was a powerful rudder that steered me into an unexpected direction. 2 years became 26 years. Why? What was the catch? And many of you have experienced this yourselves. First of all, the most important thing, a great mission. Why are we working here? What are we doing? What are we trying to accomplish? At the end of the day, what will we have done that contributed in some small way to the larger progress of the world? Great mentors, people who felt it was part of their job and to do it well, is that when they finished doing a specific job or their career, there were others behind them who took up that mantle and would do it sometimes better, sometimes differently, but keep that flow of knowledge and service and practice going. Exciting challenges, sometimes scary challenges, but being out there dealing with things that pique your intellectual interest, touch your heart as to what's going on and are unique in people's experience. How many people have had the experiences that you've had in your professional lives, even those that have just started your professional careers? It also was non-hierarchical that I liked. I had just finished my medical training, and in the U.S. you go from a student, and with each year you get a little bit more respect, but not a whole lot. And then an internship, and then a residency, a junior residency, then a senior residency. And meanwhile, you're kind of slowly inching up a ladder of a hierarchy. But even when you're finished all that training, you're still down here somewhere, and the big boss professors are up here somewhere. CDC wasn't like that. It was, we're all important, we're working together as a team, and people related to each other largely in that manner. And I thrived in that and loved the fact that whether it was in the workplace or even socially, the director of the CDC, the heads of all the centers, were readily accessible to even a new kid just arriving. And finally, a sense of camaraderie and bonding across place and time. I know a few of you here, but I still feel an identity with all of you because of the common profession we have. And it's a unique one and one to be proud of. So my 2 years of EIS apprenticeship were more powerful and fulfilling than any of my other educational experiences before that, because largely they set the direction and the tone of what was going to be the rest of my career. You may have had the same experience of looking at things differently. When I came through medical school, the focus was on one person, one body, one kidney. You were focused on something, and often it was a knee or an ear. But it wasn't anything approaching holistic. The big change in going to CDC at the time was to shift from the focus on the individual to a focus on the community and the population at large. And that's a different way of looking at the world. So here I had spent all this time and effort and many sleepless nights worrying about the organs within one person. Now I learned that what really counts is the community and all that as a whole. Actually, it's the combination of the two which makes epidemiology so attractive and wonderful. School of Public Health was useful and nice to fill in some of the niches, but the power of field epidemiology was in that apprenticeship learning, not in the traditional classroom setting. Through the EIS, again, I'm sure you have had parallel experiences and can report on them. I got to participate in the eradication of a disease, smallpox. I worked for a considerable period of time in a country, Bangladesh, that I had never visited before. I ended up doing tasks that I couldn't imagine that I could do. And if you asked me today to do them, I'd say I'm not capable of doing it. But I was so dumb that I thought, they told me to do it, I'll try to do it. And that involved doing a randomized controlled trial when I don't think I'd even read about a randomized controlled trial before doing it. It was the first time it had been done at CDC. In that same period of time, in that compact 2-year period, I got to implement a public health policy which was counter to everything else I had learned before. It was a period of time in which smallpox had shrunk to only exist in 5 or 6 countries around the world. And careful epidemiologic studies were done by colleagues at CDC, which demonstrated that your risk of death or serious illness was greater at that point from being vaccinated than not being vaccinated, because the risk of having the disease come to the U.S. at that time, given travel patterns and precautions in place, the risk was quite low for smallpox to occur. But the difficulty of communicating to a medical establishment which had grown up and had spent their whole lives valuing smallpox vaccination, as they should have, made it extremely difficult for them to countenance, we don't have to do this anymore, it's not part of the books. So this was a challenging period, and I was new to CDC, and within the first few months, I had learned enough of this background to be sent out to convince medical groups, physicians around the U.S. to stop doing the vaccine. I also was doing it, working under my great mentor, Dr. Bill Foege, the founder of the Task Force on Global Health, who was instrumental in my career. And these groups of doctors that I was going out to convince not to vaccinate, they initially had been told that Dr. Foege might come to give the talk, which was reward in and of itself. You can imagine how delighted they were to hear that he wasn't coming, but that his 16-year-old assistant was coming to give them a talk. I would always begin my talk saying, I know you're disappointed that Dr. Foege isn't here, but not as disappointed as I am that he's not here tonight. You and I share these experiences. Yours are different, but they interdigitate, and at some point it'd be wonderful to hear and read about all the different things you've done. We are all field epidemiologists, and we're skilled in a practical way in field work, many of us in lab work. So although all of us have not met before individually, I feel like this is a bit of a reunion for me. We're bound together by our trade, and what a wonderful trade. We mix science with art, storytelling and behavioral understanding. We mix laboratory and field. We tackle challenging crises, and sometimes scary and dangerous ones. Sometimes we are exhilarated by our tools and our efforts and what they produce, results and success. Our work makes a difference. I think if there was one tagline to saying TEPHINET or Field Epidemiology Training Program, it would be, we make a difference. This meeting, hopefully, will build on the success of past meetings and also expand our vision and better integrate our activities with broader public health efforts that are developing around the globe. It may be a turning point in field epidemiology training programs as we look at the new linkages that can come up. One Health, universal health coverage, new links with WHO or the World Bank or ANFI. It makes us part of a broader process and a larger public health structure and gives the impact we already have multiple increases in power. Just a little bit of history. My first involvement in an FETP-like entity was at the World Health Organization. This was in the early 80s, just to make sure we're clear, the 1980s, not the 1880s. I work with Ralph Rafe Henderson, who was then Assistant Director General. He was seconded from CDC to WHO and largely worked on immunizations and other infectious entities. He had been seconded there, and I was assigned to work with him in the early to mid-1980s to create a new WHO unit that did field epidemiology and could be deployed rapidly around the world. We worked hard at developing a protocol, a design of this program, and we thought we had produced eventually a compelling entity that would convince WHO leadership that this was a great thing to do and a great way to go. Well, we thought it was compelling, but apparently it wasn't compelling enough. And the opinion at WHO was that training was for schools of public health. They serve the training function. We disagreed. They won. But time won out, and you're all here working on in the right area in the right way. I've been a proponent of FETP and FELTP since their beginnings. And in parallel, I had the good fortune to be involved in the co-founding the International Association of National Public Health Institutes, ENFI, with my friend and colleague, Pekka Puska of Finland. In 1998, as CDC director, we had many visitors eager to learn about CDC history, evolution, budget, values, government relations, training, etc. And while proud of CDC and always happy to show people around and talk about what we did, I also felt a bit uncomfortable. Countries are of different sizes, have different levels of resources, have different types of health problems, have different cultural elements that make a one-size-fits-all model not adequate. And I felt that what we needed was, we were basically providing a rich, plentiful meal, but not one that everyone could eat or want. And so we thought we would expand the menu. Wouldn't it be better to have the person interested in, so how does one of these CDCs or a National Public Health Institute work? Ask those questions, but get answers from a lot of different places. Get them from smaller countries, from those with smaller resources to invest in it, etc. Wouldn't that be a better educational thing? And we would all benefit from it, and at the same time, work together and share our knowledge. And indeed, that's the way this has played out. I see us as hand in glove, FETP and public health institutions in which graduates of the FET programs can work and which the programs can flourish in. The National Public Health Institutes need trained staff of a high quality and high dedication. FETP provides that. Scientists, workers who can now apply their apprentice skills in an appropriate workplace. TEPHINET and EANFI are siblings who work well together and can even find more things to do together. Such apprentice training remains a pillar of CDC, whether it's for epidemiology, laboratory training, or even public health advisors, people who become the managers in public health. But FETPs and National Public Health Institutes flourish in many other sites. In fact, how many of you here trained or are training now in an FETP, which is also in the institution of a National Public Health Institute? And how many, not just trained there, but how many have now worked in a place which is both an FETP program and an EANFI member? South Africa, I see, is well represented here. Indeed, around the world, China, the China CDC, has had an active and very productive FETP program for over a decade. India, Bangladesh, and IEDCR, Ethiopia, and the Ethiopian Public Health Institute, Public Health England, as I said, the Republic of South Africa, Natalie, nice to see you again. Liberia, Pakistan, Mozambique, Zambia, Colombia, and INS all have this wonderful mix of professional training, field orientation, and an institution to develop it in. Key elements for the support and sustainability of FETPs and National Public Health Institutes as well, I've come up with three areas which I think are very important for all of us if we're going to thrive into the future and have a sustainable, well-supported institution. One is relevance. I think as we look around the world and see public health tragedies of a wide range taking place, whether it's an Ebola outbreak in West Africa or in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, or Zika, or any one of a number of infectious and non-infectious health problems, some of them environmental, that it's important for us in our national public health institutes and in our FETP programs to be engaged with them, to have something to offer, to make the outbreak detected earlier, to make the number of cases smaller, to have the latest tools to bring to the institution and to make sure there's no spread. So those outcomes, when associated with what we do, make us relevant to the public health world at large, but actually much greater than that, to society and the world in its fullest extent. A second area that I think we all can spend more energy on is evaluation. That many programs have gone on for a period of time, and while it's difficult to get good data and difficult to answer all the questions we would like to, nevertheless, it becomes really important for us to be able to document. In fact, we are the ones who are always arguing for numbers, better data, more evidence. We need to lead the way in saying the reason for investing in us, the reason for us keeping going and you being interested in us, and then be able to show what a difference we've made in some of these important health challenges. And then finally, engagement. Expanding our role. It's a wonderful to see the size of the crowd here tonight, but to continue to look for partners, new partners that we can work with, because that the additive sum is much greater than the parts when it comes to field epidemiology, public health, and improvement in the public's health through the work that we do. We need both the data, and then we need the stories, the heartwarming stories of what works and what doesn't, that will bring people to bond with us. I'm delighted to see Dr. Reddy here, an outstanding field epidemiology leader and mentor to many, who's now in the right place at the right time with the right group of people all working together. This meeting is a terrific opportunity for sharing knowledge and experience. I fully believe that this gathering and the incredible talent of you all meeting here will propel TEPHINET, AFINET, the FETP program, DD ANFI, and all who are true believers in the value of field epidemiology to expanded vital roles in improving health around the world. Thanks for having me. This is going to be a great meeting. You'll enjoy it.
Thank you very much, Dr. Koplan, for those inspiring words and for really sharing your rich experience with the audience tonight. Our second speaker for tonight is Dr. Tedros of the World Health Organization. Dr. Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus was elected as WHO Director General for a five-year term by WHO member states at the 7th World Health Assembly in May 2017. He is the first WHO Director General to have been elected from multiple candidates by the World Health Assembly, and is the first person from the WHO African region to serve as WHO's Chief Technical and Administrative Officer. Immediately after taking office on the 1st of July 2017, Dr. Tedros outlined five key priorities for the organization: universal health coverage, health emergencies, women's, children's, and adolescents' health, health impacts of climate and environmental change, and a transformed WHO. Prior to his election as WHO Director General, Dr. Tedros served as Ethiopia's Minister of Foreign Affairs from 2012 to 2016. In this role, he led efforts to negotiate the Addis Ababa Action Agenda, in which 193 countries committed to the financing necessary to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. Dr. Tedros served as Ethiopia's Minister of Health from 2005 to 2012, where he led a comprehensive reform of the country's health system. All roads lead to universal health coverage for Dr. Tedros, and he has demonstrated what it takes to expand access to health care with limited resources. Unfortunately, Dr. Tedros was not able to be with us tonight, but what he has done is he has made a video, which we will play now. And this is a significant achievement to actually have a message from the Director General of the WHO, and once more reinforces the strong links and collaboration between TEPHINET, the CDC, and the WHO. May we run that video, please?
Dear colleagues and friends, field epidemiology training is a topic that's dear to my heart. In 2009, as Minister of Health, I established an FETP program in Ethiopia with the support from CDC. Since then, 449 men and women have completed advanced training, and over 80% are now part of the public health workforce in Ethiopia. The relevance of FETP and the need for trained field epidemiologists could not be greater. Today, we're responding to over 190 outbreaks and health emergencies around the world. Every member state needs a strong field epidemiology workforce working with communities on the ground. I would like to highlight the vital contribution of FETP graduates and AFNET to the current Ebola response in DRC and the Ebola outbreak in Equator province in 2018. On many trips to the affected regions over the last 18 months, I have seen their work firsthand. In closing, I would like to recognize the important contribution of Dr. Dionisio Herrera, the dynamic and visionary director of TEPHINET. I can think of no better way of honoring his legacy than to build on his vision for FETP and to ensure that WHO's work with all of you is as successful as possible. I wish you all a productive conference, and I thank you.
Thank you very much to Dr. Tedros and for his team for facilitating the production of that video. So I was asked to declare the conference open, and my initial thoughts was, you know, perhaps there should be a cake and somebody jumping out of the cake, or there would be a ribbon and I'd cut a ribbon, but no, none of that is going to happen. So I would like to officially declare this conference open. Okay, so the conference organizing committee has drawn up a very interesting program for all of you, and it's up to you to enjoy it and to make the most of it. As is the tradition, the host country normally has the opportunity to showcase its culture and its traditions. So with that in mind, the menu for tonight's dinner will reflect the different culinary traditions of the different parts of the United States. It is a huge country and a diverse country at that. We've laid on some special jazz music for you. The American musical tradition is also very diverse and impressive. And we have a special event on the International Night. We will be commemorating Halloween, the American tradition of Halloween. So we urge you to please have fun, use the opportunity to network, and make the most of your stay here. So I've been asked, nada más unas palabras para los español parlantes. Bienvenidos. Realmente tenemos mucho gusto de tenerles aquí. Y tenemos unas juntas y tenemos muchas cosas para discutir. Y por favor, aprovecha de todo que está en oferta. Okay? Thank you very much, everybody. You have a break, I think. Dinner is programmed for 7 o'clock on the deck, so you have some time to slip into something black or something else if you would like to, and we'll see you all out on the deck, and it's an opportunity to network and get to know each other better and what we're doing. Thank you very much.